Good morning. Welcome. It's so good to see you all this morning. I know we've got a lot watching also online, so we just want to welcome you. Thank you so much for being here today as we worship together. Let's stand as we sing and worship our great Lord and Savior.
Oh Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe display. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art. His Son, not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in, that on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art. And take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great you are. Then sings my soul, how great thou art, how great thou art.
Amen. I want to read you really quick something from our devotions this morning, and this comes from a devotional that John Piper put together strictly for coronavirus. I think it's a devotional he's doing, but part of it I thought really made sense as we look to get into Hebrews and what the Bible talks about when we talk about our sovereign God. We serve an amazing God. So this is part of it. The sovereignty of God is all-compassing and all-pervasive. He holds absolute sway over this world. And he gives verses for each of these things, but I'm going to list through them. He governs the wind, the lightning, the snow, the frogs, the gnats, the flies, the locusts, the quail, the worms, the fish, sparrows, grass, plants, famine, the sun, prison doors, blindness, deafness, paralysis, fever, every disease, all of our travel plans, the hearts of kings, nations, murderers, and spiritual deadness. And all of them do his sovereign will. Our God is a solid rock.
My blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All ground is sinking sand. When darkness veils his lovely face, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. His oath, his covenant, his blood support me in the whelming flood. When all around my soul gives way, he then is all my hope and stay. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When he shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in him be found, rest in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand.
Thank you. You may be seated.
Well, again, let me offer my good morning, and thanks so much for coming. Whether you're here today or whether you're watching online, we are very grateful that you've joined us for worship at Bridge Bible Church. I know that there's a note in the bulletin expressing our condolences to the Vischer family on the loss of Mark's uncle, but I also wanted to let you know this morning that Amy Coleman's mother, Lillian Hudson, went to be with the Lord yesterday afternoon. We've been praying about that. I was able to go up to the Alma, St. Louis area and have a visit with the family a few days ago. And as you can imagine, it's a very mixed blessing. Cancer, as would be the case with so many things, is just evil. And at the same time, the family was hopeful. In fact, I walked in and they had just got done with the hymn sing. So very, very special. And in light of that, I thought about some words that the Apostle Paul, under the inspiration of the Spirit, wrote 2,000 years ago to some grieving Christians in Thessalonica. Let me read them to you. But we do not want you to be uninformed, brothers, about those who are asleep, that you may not grieve as others who have no hope. Boy, that's a sermon right there. For since we believe Jesus died and rose again, even so, through Jesus, God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep. For this we declare to you by a word from the Lord, that we who are alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a cry of command, with the voice of an archangel, and with the sound of the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will always be with the Lord. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. That's the word of the Lord. May you be encouraged today. Father, we thank you that you have left us a word that provides hope. It's our prayer this morning that whether for the Vishers or the Hudsons or those who are here who grieve other things, either death, disease, financial struggle, relationship challenges, all of those things are part of this very enjoyable but also often messy journey we call the Christian life. I thank you for words such as the ones I've just read that encourages us that this life is not everything. This world is a place of temporary residence. Our bodies are tense. They are frail. They are subject to the whims of so many factors, and yet we thank you that we have hope in your promises. We pray today that as we continue worshiping with our voices and singing songs, in some cases that are 200 or 300 years old that have been written by saints of old, that we would appreciate that we stand in a train of people, the people of God, every nation, tribe, and tongue for thousands of years, and we thank you that in a small way we can participate as that body today. We say yes to you, and I would pray in a very specific way that Todd would have skill as he unpacks the passage of Hebrews this morning, and that we would have eyes to see, ears to hear, and hearts to listen. Speak to us today. We pray these things through Christ. Amen.
I hope you can see through our songs and through our worship this morning the theme. You know, we have a great God, and he is a solid rock, and he is our firm foundation, and he's worthy. Let's stand. Let's stand as we sing. Worthy.
all excited this morning? Good, very good. Well, I'm excited this morning. I received some information about what was going to happen today. Of course, I was involved partly in the planning of this. But before I tell you what I'm excited about, I want to set the stage with a couple of questions. First question, does God speak to us today? And some of you might be wondering what exactly I'm talking about. Let me phrase it a little differently. Does God speak out loud to us in English? Does he actually do that? Does God give us audible words for today? Some of you who know my view of Scripture and theology might be surprised at my answer to the question. Before I answer the question, yes, he does, or no, he doesn't, I want to ask you another question. Question number two. If he were to speak to us audibly in English today, would you want to hear what he has to say? Looks like you all would like to hear what he has to say. A third question. What do you think the content of his message would be if he were to speak to us audibly in English today? Do you think it would be something favorable? Something that would make us feel good about ourselves? Something therapeutic? Or do you think the content of his message might include something unfavorable? Maybe a rebuke to us? Maybe something that would make us fear? I selected three different examples of the content of God's Word from various portions of Scripture, from places where he's previously spoken. And it just gives us an idea of if God were to speak to us today in English, what might be the content of what he says. The first example is from the Old Testament prophets. And I'm just going to make a statement about the Old Testament prophets. Their message was primarily negative. It was primarily a message of judgment. It was not a favorable message. It didn't make people feel good. It made those listeners who heard the message angry. In fact, they wanted to kill the prophets for the things that they were saying against the nation. The second example is the reaction of Peter and James and John at the transfiguration of Jesus as reported in Matthew chapter 17. And this is the what the NIV says from that passage. While he, that is Jesus, was still speaking, a bright cloud covered them, and a voice from the cloud said, this is God's voice, this is God's word, this is my son whom I love, with him I am well pleased, listen to him. When the disciples heard this, they fell down, face down on the ground, terrified. My point is that God's word, when it was delivered, was terrifying, at least in that situation. And then there's a third situation that I chose from Scripture. It's the letters to the seven churches in Revelation. We spoke these letters, we preached these letters several years back, chapter 2 and chapter 3 of Revelation. In those seven letters, God actually has a few positive commending statements to the people in these seven churches. And he also has many negative statements or criticisms for these churches in Asia Minor. Think about us. If he were to write a letter to our church, would he have something positive to say about us? And might he have something negative to say about us? Think about yourself as an individual. Would he have something positive to say about you? Or is there something in your life that he would desire for you to correct? Would he rebuke you in some fashion? So if we were to receive a word from God today, what would it likely say to us? What would it likely say to you? Would he be warning us of impending judgment? Would the experience be a terrifying experience? Would he commend us for some correct attitudes and behaviors? Or would he give us a warning, instruction, corrective action? To get an idea of what the content of such a message might be, I wanted to look forward a little bit into Hebrews chapter 4, which we will come to in a few weeks, verse 12 and 13. It's helpful to look at that passage. If we were to hear, let me just read a portion of it anyway. For the word of God is alive and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates to dividing soul and spirit. It judges the thoughts and attitudes of the heart. If we were to hear God's word today, Scripture tells us what we can expect from that word. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12 says that God's word functions, its function is to pass judgment. His word is the highest norm to which we must conform. His word is the standard by which we are judged. And in fact, he judges us thoroughly. He judges our thoughts and he judges our attitudes. If a message from God or a word from God in English functions as our judge, are you still sure you want to hear the word from God today? Verse 13 follows and says, "Nothing in all creation is hidden from God's sight. Everything is uncovered and laid bare before the eyes of him to whom we must give account." This is an anthropomorphism. It states that God's vision, or his sight, or his eye, sees us thoroughly. God's eye sees everything. I think in the last decade or so, it's not surprising that a person's whole life could be on audio and video, is it? In fact, it is. I'm talking to a friend in the Stans. He says, if you know the government wants to get me in trouble, they just show me a video of my life, and they can find something, you know, worth putting me in jail for. Anyway, a person's whole life could be on audio and video. Well, God has had this, shall we say, technology. He's had the technology from the beginning of time. His audio and video camera has been in operation the whole duration of your life. And he sees not merely what you do. He doesn't just see where you go. He doesn't just see who you are with. He doesn't just hear what you say. He sees everything. He sees everything external, and he sees your heart. He sees everything internal. Everything is uncovered and laid bare before his eye. Anything you might want to keep secret from anyone? Anything you might want to keep secret from anyone else is thoroughly known by God. The purpose of God's all-seeing eye, Scripture says, is to call us to account. We're supposed to be living by his standard. This is equivalent, once again, to saying that God's word is our judge. So the word of God that most of us are eager to hear functions to judge us by its standard. It entails God's all-seeing eye for the purpose of calling us to give account to God for failure to live up to that standard. So back to the original question, might God actually speak out loud in English in an audible way to us today? And I'm going to give this a qualified yes, he will. Not only might he speak, but he's going to speak this morning, and that's what's exciting. We're going to look at Hebrews chapter 3, verses 7 through 19. It's no surprise that in this paragraph, these three paragraphs actually, the Holy Spirit is speaking in the form of a warning. That's what he's been doing throughout the book of Hebrews, and he'll continue to do. It's a warning today to not turn away from the living God. It's a warning to maintain our Christian belief by avoiding sin and by guarding our hearts against sin and unbelief. If you see in the first line of chapter 3, verse 7, it says, "As the Holy Spirit says." God the Holy Spirit is speaking. He's actively speaking to the first centuries of the recipients of this letter sermon, Hebrews. And I'm going to make an argument that he's still speaking the same words to us today. He's speaking these words to you and me, the words that we're going to look at today. And of course, the words of the Holy Spirit, to hear these words audibly, someone's going to have to recite these words, and I'll do that. Some of you also noticed that chapter 3, verses 7 through 11 is actually a quotation from the Old Testament. It comes out of Psalm 95, verse 7 through 11. Listen to what the Holy Spirit is saying. Listen to his warning to us today. So as the Holy Spirit is saying today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as in the rebellion. During the time of testing in the wilderness, where your ancestors tested and tried me, though for 40 years they saw what I did. That is why I was angry with that generation. I said, their hearts are always going astray, and they have not known my ways. So I declared an oath in my anger, they shall never enter my rest. There's a principle that we learn from this quotation of Psalm 95 in Hebrews 3, and the principle is this. God's ancient word, it's older than the songs we sang. God's ancient word is applicable, it's relevant for us today. God's word is alive, it's active. Even God's word from the Old Testament is applied to these first century Christians in Hebrews 3 by the writer of Hebrews. And the ancient text of Scripture also applies to us in the 21st century. The phrase, as the Holy Spirit says, uses the word lego. Does anybody know that word? Lego. There's nothing mysterious about the word, and the word has nothing to do with a toy interlocking plastic brick. It's a word that every first-year Koine Greek language student knows thoroughly. Who's exposed to Koine Greek? Somebody. Yeah, several of you. You've heard the word lego, right? It's the paradigm for all of the verbs, almost all of the verbs. So there's nothing unusual about this word. It's a common word, and it simply means to utter words or to orally express. And the translator used the word say, which is appropriate. It's notable also that this word, lego, this word to say, is in the present tense. And the present tense indicates a thing called ongoing action. And grammarians would call it durative action. Some grammarians would even say durative action in the present time. So we could translate as the Holy Spirit says like this. The Holy Spirit is saying. The Holy Spirit continues to say. Psalm 95, which is in being quoted in verses 7 through 11 here, is a psalm of David. And it's written around 1000 BC. This is interesting. The chronology is interesting here. The psalm was written in 1000 BC. The subject matter of the psalm is the Exodus generation, 1486 BC. David's writing a song, a psalm. He's inspired to write scripture about an event that happened nearly 500 years earlier. So the Exodus generation never read this song. They never sang this song. They never heard the song, even though it was about them. Even so, the Holy Spirit, speaking through David, is using this song and applying the subject matter of the Exodus generation to King David's generation. God inspired David to write this scripture, this psalm, to teach David's generation through the negative example of their ancestors from the Exodus generation. Now, fast forward another 1,000 years. 1,000 years after David wrote this song, the writer to the Hebrews uses David's song once again as a means to warn and exhort first century Christians. The Holy Spirit was still speaking these words. The Holy Spirit was still speaking and applying these ancient words 1,500 years after the original event to the first century church. And the basis for using this psalm in Hebrews chapter 3 is that the Holy Spirit's still speaking. He's still saying this. God was still speaking his ancient word, and that word was still applicable to them in the first century. And God is still speaking to us through our English translations, through my voice quoting it this morning. And I hope you're listening to God's word, to the word of the Holy Spirit, as he warns us today from this passage. Throughout the letter sermon of Hebrews, the author uses the Exodus generation, not just here in chapter 3, but throughout the book. The Exodus generation is presented as an example not to follow. The Exodus generation is known for rebellion, for disobedience, for unbelief, so we are to not be like them. I'm going to say, don't be like them, and you say, we won't. I'm going to ask you to repeat that later a few times. There's a long list of people in chapter 11 of Hebrews. It's called the Hall of Faith chapter. These people have aspects of their lives that are worthy of imitation. We'll get to those in a few months, probably. So the point with that, the household of faith, or the Hall of Faith chapter, is we want to be like them. You know, so do be like those people. But the Exodus generation, they're like the hall of failure, the hall of faithlessness. They get a negative commentary, not only in the book of Exodus, they get a negative commentary throughout the entire book of Hebrews. They're also mentioned in 1 Corinthians and in Jude, and it's always a negative commentary for unbelief and disobedience. The passage is describing what not to do. Do not be like the Exodus generation. Don't be like them. Don't be like them. Good. So, chapter 11 of Hebrews, the Hall of Faith, chapter 3 of Hebrews, and beyond, the Hall of Faithlessness. Don't be like them. Very good. So what are we to do? Hebrews 2, we spoke a few weeks ago, was exhorting us in the first verse to pay the most careful attention to what we have heard so that we do not drift away. For how shall we escape if we ignore so great a salvation? Hebrews chapter 3 begins by exhorting us to fix our thoughts on Jesus. Later in Hebrews, after the Hall of Faith chapter, chapter 11 is chapter 12. And chapter 12 begins by encouraging us to imitate those people from chapter 11, imitate their lives of faith once again by fixing our eyes on Jesus. It's almost the same statement in chapter 12 as it is here in chapter 3. Well, why? Why must we fix our thoughts on Jesus? Hebrews has already told us to fix our thoughts on Jesus because Jesus is God's final revelation. We must fix our thoughts on Jesus, on Christ, because he is the divine human Son of God. He's preeminent. There's none better than him. We have to fix our thoughts on Jesus because he's the creator and the Lord of the universe. We fix our thoughts on Jesus because he's our high priest. He's the one and the only one who's made atonement for our sins. He's taken away our sins. He's removed God's wrath. We must fix our eyes on Jesus because Jesus, in his death, has broken the power of death, the power of sin, and the power of the devil. Wholehearted attention to Jesus, did you hear that? Wholehearted attention, not half-hearted attention to Jesus, is the only source of escape from God's wrath as the penalty for our sins. And these are the reasons we have to fix our eyes on Jesus. You and I must fix our eyes on Jesus. Well, what does it mean to fix our eyes on Jesus? Fixing one's thoughts on Jesus is described in verse 3 and verse 14 of this chapter, and it's a matter of confidence and a matter of conviction. Fixing your thoughts on Jesus means holding firmly to your confidence and the hope in which we glory. And fixing our thoughts on Jesus means holding our original conviction firmly to the very end. They're parallel statements, synonymous statements, verse 6 and verse 14. Hold firmly to our confidence in the hope in which we glory, and hold our original conviction firmly to the very end. Both of these phrases have to do with, they describe our enduring belief and our fixed allegiance to Jesus. All of this is focused on Christ. Christ is preeminent. Enduring belief and fixed allegiance to Jesus with confidence and conviction. Hebrews is referring to confidence and conviction about Christ. This confidence to which we must hold firmly is not self-confidence. It's confidence in God's word about Christ. This confidence always comes back to confidence in God's word, and it always comes back to confidence in Christ. Similarly, the conviction to which we must hold firm is not some personally derived conviction that we find within ourselves. Rather, it's the original conviction that came to us from the outside. God invaded us and gave us his word from the outside. When we heard God's word about Jesus' atoning death on our behalf, and we repented from our sins, and we believed the good news, the gospel, according to Hebrews, this original conviction demands a lifetime of diligent turning away from sin and turning in faithful reliance on Christ, who is our high priest. Christian confidence and conviction is not merely a set of teachings to affirm. It's not just something we do in our head. True Christianity is a life that is perpetually and universally conforming to God's norm, to God's word. Such confidence and conviction propels our heart toward righteousness in that direction. Fixing our thoughts on Jesus and thus possessing this confidence and conviction about him is referred to in verse 14 as sharing in Christ. We have come to share in Christ if indeed we hold our original conviction firmly to the very end. Sharing in Christ points towards sharing in the heavenly glory of the exalted Christ. The exalted Christ is the emphasis in Hebrews. Hebrews does talk in a limited way about Christ's death. It talks extensively about his suffering, but the lion's share of the emphasis is on the exalted Christ. And sharing in Christ points towards sharing in the heavenly glory of the exalted Christ. Sharing this glory with Jesus in the presence of God in the future, certain hope for Christians. So Jesus, once again, is the central focus of this sermon letter, Hebrews. Jesus is also the central focus of the meta-narrative of the entire scripture, both Old Testament and New Testament. And this is why Hebrews keeps repeating the theme of the preeminence of Christ. He spends 10 chapters talking about the preeminence of Christ. And then we, the church, are motivated by the preeminence of Christ to persevere in Christian belief. Christ is the object of our perseverance. The opposite of sharing in Christ is in verse 12. It's referred to as turning away from the living God. You'll see that turning away from the living God is a heart problem. Hebrews calls it a sinful heart of unbelief, or the ESV calls it an evil or wicked, unbelieving heart. And Hebrews is warning against this. Think of yourself. Do you think that you would ever turn away from the living God? Apostasy is what this section of scripture is talking. Do you think you'd ever do that? Do you think you'd ever fail to enter God's rest? How could this happen? The Exodus generation, here's going to be your participation once again. The Exodus generation failed to listen to God's word. Verses 7 through 11 talks of that. They heard God's word with their ears, but they failed to internalize it. God's word did not penetrate their heart. And these failures are that for which the Exodus generation is notorious. Don't be like them. As has just been said, today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as you did in the rebellion. Who were those who heard and rebelled? Were they not all those Moses led out of Egypt? And with whom was he angry for 40 years? Was it not with those who sinned, whose bodies perished in the wilderness? And to whom did God swear that they would never enter his rest, if not to those who disobeyed? So we see that they were not able to enter because of unbelief. You see the correlation between disobedience and unbelief. Turning away from the living God versus sharing with Christ or sharing in Christ has to do with sin and unbelief, verse 12. It has to do with disobedience and unbelief, verse 18 and 19. Sin and unbelief are failure to respond favorably to God's word, failure to say yes to God's word. Turning away from the living God is not usually the conscious objective of the people who ultimately end up turning away from Christian belief. And you know some of those people. They didn't start out deciding to apostatize. That's not how they start. The reason Hebrews articulates so many serious warnings in this letter is because we are so often deceived. Verse 13 speaks of being hardened by sin's deceitfulness. The main warning in this whole passage from 7 to 19 comes in verse 8. It says, "Do not harden your heart." It's a phrase from Psalm 95, verse 8, that says, "Do not harden your hearts." It's quoted three times in this passage, that phrase. It's in verse 8 of chapter 3, verse 15 of chapter 3, and then chapter 4, verse 7. Each of those three times, the verb harden is in the active voice. The subject is doing the action. The subject is doing the hardening. Here in verse 13, it's different. Harden is in the passive voice. The subject is being acted upon. It's not the subject himself doing the action. Verse 13 refers to being hardened by sin's deceitfulness. It seems that voluntary or willful participation in sin is associated with an involuntary hardening of a person's heart. There's a voluntary aspect and there's an involuntary aspect of the same thing. When we sin, we are after the pleasures and the temporary fulfillments. But sin, it comes with associated baggage. It causes the unintended and undesirable consequences of a hardened heart. Sin is deceitful in that way. Sin offers you more than you expect, more than you wanted. It offers you a hardened heart. Participation in sin has the consequence of hardening a person's heart before God, hardening a person's heart toward the Word of God. It doesn't seem like sin would do this, but it does. Sin is turning away from God. Sin causes you to turn further away from God. Sin is deceitful because Satan is deceitful. Sin promises, but ultimately it doesn't deliver. Sin lies. Sin deceives. Sin deceives subtly and sometimes slowly, like a boat drifting in a gentle breeze. It seems so pleasant. There's a sense of control. But all the while, you're relinquishing your control to sin. A step toward sin is a step toward apostasy. A step away from perpetual and universal righteousness is a step toward apostasy. That's why it's important to heed the warning. Heed the imperative of verse 12. The first phrase in NIV says, "See to it." Our other translations say, "Take care. Be careful. Be watchful. Watch your step. Watch out." It's a warning. It's imperative. "See to it, brothers and sisters, that none of you has a sinful, unbelieving heart that turns away from the living God." This is a warning to be careful to guard your heart against wickedness, against evil, against sin. Sin is a failure in the realm of faith. Hebrews describes the heart as a wicked, unbelieving heart. He describes a heart of unfaith, a heart that doesn't have faith. Sin causes a person's heart to become hardened. And a hardened heart is less and less and less responsive to God's word. Sin is the pathway for turning away from the living God. And such was the pattern of the Exodus generation. Don't be like them. Such a pattern is a failure to respond to the word of God with a perpetual and universal and enduring yes to righteousness. And a perpetual and universal and enduring no to sin. A step away from perpetual and universal righteousness is a step toward apostasy. And apostasy means to turn away from the living God. Now, some of you are thinking, perpetual and universal righteousness. It sounds good, but that's really the opposite of my experience. Some of you have been discouraged, or maybe even given up the battle against sin, because of repeated failures in the same sins, over and over, falling back in the same sins that you've committed time and time again. The encouraging thing is that God has not left us alone to struggle with sin by ourselves. In Hebrews, there's a lot of words used, a lot of parchment space used, regarding the battle of sin, disobedience, and unbelief. And much of what is said is directed toward personal effort, toward diligence, toward careful watchfulness, toward caution. But Hebrews also informs us that God is involved. He's working in us what is pleasing to him. We're informed also that we have a merciful and faithful high priest, Jesus, who is helping those who are being tempted. In fact, chapter 7, verse 25 says that he's able to save completely those who come to God through him, because he always lives to intercede for us. He's not like the other priests who died. They had a life expectancy. Jesus doesn't have any life expectancy. His life goes on. He's able to intercede for us indefinitely. Here in Hebrews, there's a different emphasis in chapter 12, or verse 12 and verse 13. There is help for overcoming sin in addition to personal effort, in addition to God's work, and in addition to Jesus' intercession. Do you know what it is? Oh, it's the persuasion of the community, the persuasion of the church. It's the Christian community. See to it, brothers and sisters, that none of you has a sinful, unbelieving heart that turns away from the living God, but encourage one another daily, as long as it is called today, so that none of you may be hardened by sin's deceitfulness. Verse 13 says, but encourage one another. What is one of the primary means that the sovereign God uses to accomplish the perseverance of believers? He uses your involvement in the Christian community of believers. It's the persuasion of the community. You must have a vital relationship with a Christian church to benefit from this means of perseverance. Notice the plural pronouns in verses 12 and 13. Incidentally, any of you heard of the translation, the NST? The New Southern Translation? Are you reading that one this year? Okay. See how it reads. See to it, brothers and sisters, that none of y'all has a sinful, unbelieving heart that turns away from the living God, but encourage one another daily, as long as it is called today, so that none of y'all may be hardened by sin's deceitfulness. I learned this language for over the last 2 or 3 years. The NST says none of y'all. What Hebrews is saying, that y'all are responsible for y'all.
each of us is responsible not only for our own perseverance in Christian belief, we're responsible to encourage one another to persevere. We're to be involved in each other's lives in that way. This means that we are watching and being careful that our fellow Christians maintain robust Christian belief and robust Christian behavior. We're supposed to be helping one another in the battle against sin and disobedience and unbelief. How serious are you about your Christian walk? How serious are you about my Christian walk? How serious are you about the Christian walk of those seated near you or those with you in your home? How serious are you about the Christian walk of those you go to school with, to those Christians with whom you work? Hebrews apparently believes that people have a proclivity towards sin and disobedience and unbelief because he does not trust any of us to remain faithful for more than 24 hours. He says, encourage one another daily, frequently. Not only do you and I need to get spiritual encouragement from the church, you and I need to be giving exhortation to those members of the Christian church. It's necessary to be involved and to be encouraged by a believing community. Hebrews doesn't refer to me and Jesus. It refers to we and Jesus. It's a group effort. Takes a village. Takes a church. Not only do I have responsibility to trust and obey myself, I'm also responsible that you trust and obey. And the same is true for you. You are responsible that I trust and obey. I need church. You need church. Church is essential for persevering in Christian belief. If you or I disregard church and its influence and its God-ordained authority structure, then you and I are one step closer to apostasy. That's how the devil works. God's method and his means for Christian perseverance is the Christian church. So let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, because he who promised is faithful. And let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds, not giving up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another. We're commanded to meet together with the explicit purpose of spurring one another on and encouraging and exhorting one another to remain diligent in our Christian belief, in our Christian behavior. Hebrews leaves us in a bit of an uncomfortable situation with regard to assurance of salvation. What many of us want to be told is that our past conversion experience, or a prayer that we prayed, or a religious experience guarantees our final salvation. What Hebrews gives us instead is an exhortation to persevere in Christian belief and Christian behavior to the end. The objective of the author to Hebrews is to offer a word of exhortation, chapter 13, 22. This word of exhortation is a word to persevere. Hebrews presents to us the preeminence of Christ, those first 10 chapters. He does this to motivate the perseverance of the church because of the preeminence of Christ. Then perseverance is aided by this persuasion of the community. Perseverance requires a perspective of the consummation, which will come in later sermons. And perseverance is ultimately by the power of the Creator. As a word of exhortation, Hebrews offers assurance of final salvation only to those who do not turn away in apostasy. He offers assurance of salvation only to those who do not turn away from the living God. So is assurance of final salvation then an illusion, something we can't get a hold of? It's something out of our grasp. Not at all. We are his house. if indeed we hold firmly to our confidence and the hope in which we glory. We have come to share in Christ, if indeed we hold our original conviction firmly to the very end. We're told that God's means of perseverance includes personal effort. It includes God working in us. It includes Jesus helping and interceding for us. It includes the persuasion of the community. In this section, the emphasis is on personal effort. Number one there. Even though we know that God's at work, even in this, by means of our personal effort. So how do we avoid turning away from the living God? How do we maintain our original conviction regarding Christ? How do we exercise personal effort toward this goal of perseverance in Christian belief? Perseverance in Christian belief requires personal means, and I've listed five things there. Out of the text, first, hearing and listening to God's word. Perseverance in Christian belief requires hearing and listening to God's word. Reading God's word. Listening to God's word. Memorizing his word. Meditating on it. Having it permeate your daily routine. Study it. Teach it to other people. Talk about it when you sit at home, when you walk along the road, when you rise up, and when you lie down. Perseverance in Christian belief also requires responding to God's word with a perpetual yes. This means that when you have an opportunity to obey God, the answer is yes. And 20 minutes later, when you have another opportunity to obey God, the answer is yes. And 30 minutes later, when you have an opportunity to obey God, the answer is yes. And it's a perpetual yes. And it's a perpetual yes because you decided in advance that it's going to be a perpetual yes. Perseverance in Christian belief requires responding to God's word with a universal yes. This means that every additional opportunity to obey is met with a yes. Not just the big things, it's the little things. You don't keep any secret sins. You don't keep any little sins. You don't keep any maybe God won't notice type of things. It's a universal yes. In every area of your life, you say yes to God's will in obedience. Perseverance in Christian belief requires also responding to God's word with an enduring yes. This means that you respond with yes for the duration of your life. You persevere in Christian belief. And then, as we already mentioned, perseverance in Christian belief requires participation in the persuasion of the community, both as a receiver and as a giver. The Exodus generation did not respond to God's word with persevering faith. Do not be like them. I'm reading a second read from a book where the author is John Owen. Printing date, 1658. It is a translation from English to English, because it would be very difficult to read the 1658 English. But let me read you just a paragraph. In temptation, Satan's desire is to deceive you like a serpent, to devour you like a lion. The sin he tempts you to, against God's law, not the goal he's aiming at. Satan's design lies against your interest in the gospel. He uses sin as a bridge to get over to a better ground, to assault your interest in Christ. Apostasy. That's what he wants. He will say today, you may participate in sin because you have an interest in Christ. And then tomorrow, he will tell you, you have no interest in Christ because of that very sin. Satan's goal is beyond specific sins. His goal is your apostasy. His temptation toward apostasy is deceitful. So it's critical to maintain a perpetual and universal and enduring yes to God's word, and a perpetual and universal and enduring no to sin. We have come to share in Christ if indeed we hold our original conviction firmly to the very end. If you heed the instruction of Psalm 119, you will not be like the Exodus generation. Listen to Psalm 119. Blessed are those whose ways are blameless, who walk according to the law of the Lord. Blessed are those who keep his statutes, who seek him with all their heart. They do no wrong, but follow his ways. You have laid down precepts that are to be fully obeyed. Oh, that my ways were steadfast in obeying your decrees. Then I would not be put to shame when I consider all your commands. I will praise you with an upright heart as I learn your righteous laws. I will obey your decrees. Do not utterly forsake me. How can a young person stay on the path of purity? By living according to your word. I seek you with all my heart. Do not let me stray from your commands. I've hidden your word in my heart, that I might not sin against you. Praise be to you, Lord. Teach me your decrees. With my lips, I recount all the laws that come from your mouth. I rejoice in following your statutes as one rejoices in great riches. I meditate on your precepts and consider your ways. I delight in your decrees. I will not neglect your word. Now, may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with everything good that you may do his will, working in us what is pleasing to him, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Amen.
Todd, thank you so much for feeding us so well today. I'm in the process of teaching a class at Cornerstone right now called Principles of Self-Management. One of the things that the students have to do is they have to write out their life mission statement. And as I engage with those things, I've thought a lot, in fact, with great frequency, what are the things my life is all about? And Todd, as you were preaching this morning, I thought about one of my life principles is found over in Hebrews chapter 13. There's an interesting admonition at the end of the book. Obey your leaders and submit to them, for they are keeping watch over your souls as those who will have to give an account. Let them do this with joy and not with groaning, for that would be of no advantage to you. And it reminds me again of the gratitude that I have for those who team with us to teach God's word every Sunday and in other venues. And also, just know, folks, that, again, you're not alone. We have a team of staff. We have a team of elders. We have other godly men and women in the church who would be happy to come alongside you and help walk you through these aspects of our journey. As I say often, we're meant to have authentic community. And if we can help you with any aspect of your Christian walk, including some of the things that Todd touched on today, please talk with us, because we're all in this thing together. Thanks for coming. Know that you are loved. I hope you have a really good Sunday. Don't run off. Meet some new people. You're dismissed.